saw a city that could not be hid. John saw the city. Oh, yes, he did. John caught a glimpse of the golden throne. Tell me all about it. Go right on around the throne. He saw a crystal sea. I want to go. There's got to be more. What will it be? I want to go to that city he saw. New Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I want to walk your streets that are golden, and I want to run where the angels have trod. Jerusalem, I want to rest on the banks of your river, in that city, city. Down by the lamb, I wanna know everything about that land. John saw the day but did not see night. The Lamb of God, well, must be the light. He saw the saints worship the great I am, crying, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. I want to go to that city he saw, New Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I want to walk your streets that are golden, and I want to run where the angels have trod.
All right. If you would, take your Bibles and open them to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians 4, and we will look at verse 8. I appreciate Annette singing that song for us so very much. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. If you would, please follow as I read. Paul wrote these words and said, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things." May God bless the reading of His Word. Do you remember several years ago when Christians in the church used this acronym WWJD? It was very, very popular. I mean, we saw it everywhere. We saw it on car tags, on bumper stickers, on t-shirts and caps, and on jewelry like necklaces and bracelets and even rings. WWJD. Now, what it stood for then and still does now is, what would Jesus do? The question then, and the question still is, if we are in a very worldly, trying, tempting situation in our life, we need to ask, what would Jesus do if He were in our shoes, if He were in our place? Now, I preached a series of sermons on this, and I entitled it the What Would Jesus Do series. Preached it in 2004. Now, that's been 16 years ago. So I rebuilt these sermons, and I'm going to re-preach this again. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be asking the question, what would Jesus do if He were in our shoes, if He were in our place? Now, all of us, it is obviously certain that every one of us, as Christians, as children of God, we should walk like He walked. We should live like He lived. We should love like He loved, forgive like He forgave, and think like He thought. Oh, speaking of that last one, that's my message for this morning. If we are in a very difficult, worldly situation, and we don't know how to respond to it, if we are in a situation where we have a great decision to make in our life, and we don't know how to respond to that in our life, we need to sit back a moment and ask the question, what would Jesus think about this? Now, we say, I don't know what Jesus would think, because there's no way we could probe the mind of our Lord. There's no way we can know what would be on His mind. I beg to differ on that. You know, we don't know everything that is on His mind, but we can look at His Bible, His Word. We can look at the inerrant and infallible, divine, holy Word of the living, almighty God, and we can see His life and how He lived, and that can give us a very good idea as to how Jesus would possibly or probably think about a certain situation. And that would help us then to respond accordingly. So listen then, I want to share three things that I believe were always on His mind. Number one, I believe that He thought of love and forgiveness towards sinners. All right, now does that sermon or does this message then have any application to us, since I just said that Jesus has love and forgiveness towards sinners? I mean, if we're not a sinner, then this message has no application and we're all free to go right now. But no, we cannot go. Know why? Because we're all sinners. Oh, we know the verses. We know them. We have heard them quoted. We have read them countless times, and we know what they are. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And Romans 3:10 says, therefore it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. So we all know that we are sinners. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. We all know it. We all come short of the glory of God. What does God think about this? About the fact that we all are sinners? Well, I will tell you this. He hates all sin. God hates sin with a passion. You say, God hates sin with a passion? God hates, I cannot comprehend or think that God would hate or hate anything. But no, he does. God hates sin with a passion. And we see evidence of that passion when Jesus laid down upon that cross on Calvary's hill. That is the passion of the Christ. He hated sin so much that God sent his only begotten Son unto that cross for us. And his Son hated sin so much that he's willing to die on that tree so that we, through his shed blood, may be forgiven. God hates sin. And he wants you and I to hate sin. And I will tell you this, that God hates sin and he will discipline all sinners. Whether we are saved or whether we are lost, God will discipline and judge all sin. He will take us as Christians to the woodshed, and he'll do whatever is necessary to correct us and to get us on the right path if we get off on the wrong path. And if one does not know Jesus as Lord and Savior, and they reject him, then when they breathe their last, they will burn in the fires of hell. That is not something I rejoice in. That is something I say regretfully, but it's the truth. They will. God hates sin, but as much as he passionately hates sin, he equally loves the sinner who commits the sin. Come on, someone say amen. Amen. Every man and every woman rightly deserves to be punished by God when we sin, when we fall short. Isaiah 30 verse 18 says that the Lord God is a God of judgment. He will judge our sin. And I'll tell you, as we a lot of us have the wrong concept. A lot of us think that as long as we're a good person in life and we do good deeds, we'll be all right as long as the good outweighs the bad. It doesn't work that way. I heard that a police officer one time pulled somebody over for speeding, and he was going to write them a ticket. Simple traffic violation. And the person behind the steering wheel said to the officer, he said, but sir, I know I was speeding, but let me tell you something. This morning, when I woke up, I had fully intended to go rob the bank in town. And I didn't do it. And not only that, just a little while ago, I helped a little old lady cross the road. Now, that's two good things I did today, officer. And the officer said, I get it. I understand what you're saying. You're saying that the good outweighs the bad, so therefore, since you did two good deeds against this one, that I should let you go. And he said, please? The officer said, no. The officer said, no, and he wrote the ticket. You see, that's the way it is with God. We might be good old boys and girls. We might be good old men and women. We might be good people. We might do good in our life, but the good cannot ever outweigh the bad. When God sees sin, he will deal with it. He will not sweep it under the rug. He will deal with it. He'll take care of it. And will not get away with it. Will not get by with it. Now, let me tell you this, though. When God looks at us as sinners, what's on his mind? He hates our sin, but he forgives us. Because he loves us. Can you believe that? God loves us despite who we are or whatever we may have ever done. He may not love what we do, but he loves us. And on the cross, everyone imagined this. Everyone visualized Jesus with the arms stretched out, saying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He forgave us. Now, we can look at that and we can say, well, now that's good then. Since he has forgiven us, that means that we can just do whatever we want to do in life, and then at the end of the day, we can go to him and repent and ask forgiveness, and it'll all be all right. And no, it doesn't work that way. Just because God forgives us for our sin does not give us an excuse to sin. Come on, say it. Amen. Just because God forgives us and loves us passionately does not excuse us to sin. He said to us in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, "My little children, these things I send to you, that you sin not, that you sin not." See, he didn't say, if you sin, it'll be all right. He said, sin not. But then he did say, though, that if we do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he has forgiven us, and he will forgive us, but it doesn't give us an excuse to sin. Let's look at Jesus then. What would he think? What did Jesus think about people who were very worldly, immoral, and sinful in the Bible? And he approached a lot of folks like that. You know, he did. For example, the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. Oh, that woman, hey, she'd been married several times, but she was living with a man. Jesus said to her, he's telling her that what she was doing was wrong. And Jesus, I'm sure, even though we cannot know what was on his mind, I'm sure that when he looked at that Samaritan woman, I'm sure he was thinking, you are a very sinful, worldly person. But he loved her and he forgave her. Amen. He loved that woman and forgave her. Amen. He did not hold it against her. I'm sure that somehow, some way, he dealt with her sin. God deals with all sin, but he forgave her because he loved her. And he showed her the way to have spiritual water, the spiritual water that we can drink, where we can live for all eternity, forevermore. And this woman, she went home and just shouted to everyone, "Come see a man which told me all things that ever I have done. Is not this the Christ?" And then I think about that tax collector who was sitting way up high in a tree. He cheated so many people out of their money. A crook is what he was, a bad person. Jesus came up and he said, "Zacchaeus, come down from that tree, for today I must abide in your house with you." And Zacchaeus came down. Jesus showed him the way to salvation. Jesus saved his soul and then said in Luke 19:10, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost." I'm sure that when Jesus saw that little man sitting up high in that tree, he saw a crook, he saw a bad person, he saw a bad man. And that was on what was on his mind. That's what Jesus was thinking at the time. But then Jesus also in his mind was thinking, this is a man with a soul that I am come to save. And there's so many others like that. So many others. How about the thief on the cross? Jesus is on that middle cross. And that thief that's beside him, one of them ridiculed and rebuked him. And he died and went to hell. The other one beside him, Jesus looks at him. And Jesus looks over and sees a man who was on a cross just like him. And that man, I don't know what he had done. Perhaps it says he was a thief. Maybe he had killed somebody. I don't know what that other thief had done in his life. But he's a bad, bad person. Jesus looks over at him and thinks in his mind, a bad person. But also thinks in his mind, he has a soul. And that person on that cross said, will you remember me, Lord, when you enter into kingdom, your kingdom today? And Jesus said, verily I say unto you that today you shall be in paradise. And you say, well, that's people in the Bible. Hey, yeah, I know. Look, you and I. Jesus looked down at us once upon a time. He looked at us in eternity future and eternity past, whatever you want to call it. He looked at us. And he said, that man, that woman, they are sinners. They are bound for hell because of their sin nature. And that's what he thought of us. And then he thought of us. These are people of whom I want to go and lay down and take the old rusty nails and die so they can live forevermore. That was on his mind. That was on his mind. I shall tell you this. We're all commanded to love and forgive sinners. Suppose someone were to come into the church and we look at this person and we say, it's a young lady. And the young lady has gotten pregnant out of wedlock. And we say, this young lady is bearing child. She's not even married. We can judge. Or we can see a woman that has come into the church and we can say that this lady has been unfaithful to her husband. She has committed adultery, and the word's getting out. The rumors are being spread, and we all know it. Or we can have a man that can walk into the church who maybe he was arrested for a DUI, and we can say he is a bad dude, a bad man. And we all rest in judgment. We can have that on our mind. And logically speaking, that will probably be on our mind. We can say they're a disgrace. They're an embarrassment, that they should be punished, that they should leave this church, and that they should never be forgiven. What would Jesus think about them? Same way he thought about all of us. I believe what Jesus would do is he'd get down on his knees, and I believe he would write a message, just like he did when they brought the adulterous woman out to him. And I believe he would look out to every one of us and say, he that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone. And then I believe he would say, I do not condemn you, but go and sin no more. God would deal with the sin, but he would forgive the sinner. That's exactly what Jesus would do. We cannot accept sin. We must despise it and hate it with a passion, just like Jesus does. But love and forgive the sinner. Listen, as I've already said, sin should be punished, but not by us. Matthew 7:1 says, judge not that ye be not judged. Romans 2:1 says, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself, for thou that judgest doest the same things. There's only one judge, only one lawgiver, and only one judge. And that is the one who went to the cross. That is our Lord. In Romans 12:19, it says, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Amen. Crimes should be punished. What about those who have committed crime and are behind prison bars? What about them? We could say they are there where they deserve to be, depending on the crime, certainly. If someone commits a crime, do the time. They should be behind bars in the prison, but we must not turn our backs even on them because they have a soul that needs salvation. Amen. Do you know that Paul had a prison ministry? And even though Paul despised sin, for he, at one time, Paul knew about sin because there's one time Paul said, even after he got saved, he said, look, I'm the chief of sinners. Paul said that. But Paul had a prison ministry, so I don't know about his prison ministry. Which epistle is that in? Well, I can find it in the book of Acts, in that very popular verse that I love so much, Acts 16:25, that at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. So even though they themselves were in the shadow of dying, and they were in shackles. They were bound on the cold, dark dungeon floor. Those men prayed, and they sang praises. The prisoners heard them. Did any of the prisoners hear their praise and they're singing. I don't know if any of them got saved, but I do know the jailer did and his family did. Paul cared, and so should we. Jesus thought about love and forgiveness towards sinners. He also thought about leading lost souls to salvation. See, Jesus always had lost souls on his mind. As I said, Luke 19:10, he said, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost." He had us on his mind when he went to the cross. You know the song? "I'm so unworthy of such mercy. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind." When Jesus was on the cross, we were on his mind. One day, he saw a blind beggar sitting on the side of the road. And that blind beggar, he couldn't see, so Jesus took some mud and put it in the blind beggar's eyes, told him to go wash in the pool of Siloam, and he did. But Jesus not only wanted him to see physically, he wanted him to see spiritually. So in John chapter 9, 35 through 38 is where we find this. Jesus said to that man that he had healed of his physical blindness, but yet he was still spiritually blind. And what good would it be for any of us to see physically and not see spiritually? What good would it be for any of us to be alive and breathing well and in good health in this life, but yet be dead spiritually? Wouldn't be any good, would it? So he said to that blind man that he could now see, "Dost thou believe on the Son of God?" And he said, "Who is he, Lord, that I might believe?" And Jesus said, "Thou hast but seen him, and it is he that speaketh with thee." And then he said, "I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus had lost souls on his mind. And we should have lost souls on our mind as well. That should be in our thoughts. That should be what we as Christians are thinking about. What if someone were to come into the church that we said they just don't fit in? They're not like us. They're different. And I don't want them here. Maybe they have a bad reputation. Maybe they have committed a terrible sin, a terrible crime, whatever. Don't want them around. Listen, we need to say, everyone has a soul. And I care about that person. And I care about them knowing the Lord Jesus as Savior. Paul had a burden for the lost. In Romans 9:2, he said, "I have great compassion, great heaviness, and continual sorrow in my heart." Paul, and that verse, and I didn't read the whole verse there, that verse goes on, it says that Paul loved the lost so much that he even prayed this to the Father. He did. He said, "God, even if it means that I lose my salvation, that my fellow Jews will receive salvation, I'm willing." That was something for Paul to say. And Paul didn't want to lose his own salvation, but he loved others so much he wanted to see everyone saved. What do we think about lost people? What would Jesus think? And then I will say this, he thought about worshiping his Father. Jesus, we can see him in his life, in the life that he lived. We can see him in the steps that he took, in the places where he went, in the days that would come and go. We can see that Jesus would continually, always adore his Father. He would either bow down somewhere and pray to his Father, he would praise his Father, and he'd tell everyone else about his Father. He adored his Father in heaven. And likewise, we all should be thinking about God all the time. We should adore the Lord our God. Brethren, we have met, as the hymn says, to worship and adore the Lord our God. Matthew 6:9 says, Jesus one time, he said to the disciples, "After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." He thought about his Father. His thoughts were centered upon him. And we should always have God on our mind. We should always be in a spirit of praise and worship. Matthew 5:16 says, "Let your lights so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." God wants everyone to glorify Him, and it should be contagious. We should, around one another, we should love and adore God and worship Him so much and praise Him so publicly and so much that everyone around us wants to do likewise. Amen. Nothing else should be on our mind. As I close, in 1 Corinthians, chapter 2, verse 16 says, "Who shall know the mind of Christ?" Who can know the mind of Christ? You know, you ever seen these men that or women or whoever, they're what they call mind readers? We went to Gatlinburg one time. This man was reading minds. I was wanting to get out of that place. I didn't want him to read my mind. But he was supposedly reading minds. Not that I was thinking bad thoughts, but I just didn't. It wasn't his business. But I know someone who can read minds, and that's the Lord our God. He can read our minds. He knows what we're thinking about right now. Hey, are we looking at our watch and thinking about it's time to go eat lunch? Are we thinking about it? God knows it. Are we thinking about it's time to go somewhere else or do some other thing or whatever? I just wish the preacher would end this sermon. God knows what we're thinking. He knows what's on our mind. Who can know the mind of Christ? We can't know everything that He's thinking. But we can have a general idea as to what would be on his mind by looking at his life that he lived, as I said. And we have that mind of Christ. It says also in that same verse, we have that mind of Christ. That is, we have been given his way of thinking. His way of thinking is revealed to us in his word. We have been given the mind of Christ. We have been given his way of thinking by the life that he lived. So how we can take our minds and use them in the right way to live the Christian life, look at the life that Jesus lived and let us think as Jesus would think. That's my message for today. I thank you for listening. May we pray.